We are in Newberry, South Carolina at the garden of Dr. John Green. I came to this garden because the Newberry Chamber of Commerce was having a garden festival that was being organized in a very safe manner. And oh my goodness, when I got here, it was just the most wonderful thing. And in addition to taking us to such beautiful gardens, they had artists doing plein air in each garden. And Robert Matheson was sitting here painting a mutabilis rose. And it is quite beautiful, and I enjoyed meeting him as well. But the person responsible for this garden is Dr. John Green, and we want to thank you so much for letting us come.
My pleasure.
And this is full sun, and it's a warm day, but your yard has great diversity, and you have deciduous trees that really give you a chance to do things a little differently.
Particularly in the front and on the side, we're able to get enough sun in to have good blooming of the camellias, the native azaleas, with the hydrangeas now. And then coming around to the side, we have some blooming of the caria and of the Rose of Sharon.
Yes.
That allow in that section sun, which by the end of the summer will have become very shady.
And then that is also a place where you very interestingly have a completely seasonal winter vegetable garden, I believe.
Yes. These are the cabbages, the broccolis, the cauliflowers, the beets, the spinaches that we will start in seed, and then we'll put them out in the February, early March, and watch them grow during that time. But by the time it hits 90 degrees, those plants will have run their course, and that garden will be put to sleep.
And fortunately, you have other areas where you can grow vegetables.
Yes.
As we come on around to the back of the house, the space becomes a little bit smaller, and there you start using rock and getting some three-dimensional beds there. And I think that there's actually a purpose for that.
Yes, behind the house, we did four brick, 4 foot high, 3.5, 4 foot high raised beds for seasonal flowers to help bring color close into the house. And then we've brought in a lot of the rock that we have found it around on the property to help outline some of the beds in the perennial beds in the back of the house, just because it makes it part of the nature of the property.
Well, and being a proponent of nature, you decided that you would have another type of animal back there.
The July 4th holiday that I decided to, out of red clay, dig down a 2 foot deep fish pond is a memorable. There's got to be a better way to do it, but still, it is now so enjoyable to have the little koi and the goldfish back there to help remind that nature has a lot of different beautiful forms.
The greenhouse is when your apparent addiction to football is over, you retreat to the greenhouse, and what all do you do there?
In January is the prime time to start all the seeds, although you have to time them out so that you don't get them too mature too quickly. But that makes life enjoyable out there. I tend to have the orchids that will bloom in the winter, early spring, so that I can enjoy them. And then there are a lot of just plants that I have accumulated that you try to maybe propagate, do some cuttings on. But it just makes life during those winter months that tend to be a little bit gray and dull outside, you bring a growing greenness inside.
So then we come to a part of the yard where I should have put on a little more sunscreen for today, because we have full sun over here, even though we're surrounded by trees.
We have been able to open this area up so that plants that do like a full sun seem to thrive.
And you have what is a daunting soil type for many gardeners. It is red clay, and that can be pretty hard to deal with, and you have done, I think, a pretty wonderful engineering project with creating these beds so that they can hold water, but you can move excess water off the property. Tell me how you've gone about that process.
By terracing the area with the walkways in between, it allows both the raised beds to be unique into themselves, and they can then the water will travel then down the pathways. Each of the beds for the roses tend to hold water into as a large container type thing. And with the clay, you tend to be able to then to, for a week or two of heat, have no problem with the moisture.
Because you water by hand, you do not have automatic irrigation.
That is correct.
Yeah. And in the front, I just wish I could come up and have supper in about a month because the vegetables look like they are just off to a wonderful start.
They are part of that early greenhouse growing that makes that part fun. And then you see what the seeds do. They reward you with these plants, be it the tomatoes, the melons, the peppers, the beans, the squash.
And you can try different varieties and see which ones you prefer.
There are probably 8 or 10 different tomato types out here. Oh, there's 4 or 5 different cherry tomatoes out here. Just to be able to do that. If you like them, fine. If you don't, next year, find something different.
Oh my goodness, the roses. And you've been doing roses for about 20 years. Is that a relatively new passion? And they are exquisite, but they do take work. And you first start with pruning, I believe, at a somewhat unusual time of the year.
By the end of the year, many of the bushes are 6 to 10 feet tall. So in January, I will come and try to bring them down to about 5 feet with a pruning to do that. That also helps to protect them from high winds that we get. And then when 1st of March comes around, I will come back and reprune down to the level that to allow the early spring flush to come out as it has, try to open up the centers and everything.
And you do not use insecticide, and hello little pollinator on the rose, but you do, because it's South Carolina, find it necessary to use fungicides.
Yes, I don't know that there is an organic way in South Carolina to grow roses like this. So we use a mixture of a contact and then a systemic fungicide that we'll put on about every 2 to 3 weeks.
But then that time comes when those darn Japanese beetles come and you really come out and hand work on them and try to keep the numbers limited.
Yes, we'll make 2-3 rounds a day. We'll get hundreds of the Japanese beetles knocked off. They tend to want to fall straight down. So I'll hold a soapy water container under it. They fall down.
And then after they've stayed in that water for a little while, they're no longer living and you can dump them out and come back 2 hours later and start over again.
It almost seems that when you finish the end, you could almost start over again sometimes. But
I love the way that you've used all this granite and native rock that you found in the woods surrounding. And we were just talking about the fact that my back hurts sometimes, and you told me that you have gotten tired of bending over all the time. So the miniatures, I think, you've kind of created an up bed for them.
I got to the point that I was neglecting the miniatures because it meant you had to get down on your knees. So I said, well, you know, I've got these areas that are into the bank areas. I'll just go ahead and use that natural slope. So using the granite block on this one, using the field stone on that one, we've raised area now for about 25 miniatures that we have lined around, and I'm enjoying them a lot more.
One miniature you said is kind of specially known for South Carolina and was developed by the very famous rosarian we had here, I believe.
Michael Williams was a world-class hybridizer of miniatures, mini floras. In fact, this is one of his roses too. But the Palmetto Sunrise is a fantastic miniature that I'm enjoying over there. But he was a much of a person who had gotten me to do roses and to do them better.
There's some fun things here. One of them is called ketchup and mustard, which is just kind of a curiosity.
It's a floribund of it.
But one rose has a lovely story with it and really is, I think, should get credit for the huge interest we have in all the reblooming roses. Would you share that story with us, please?
Old Blush, the pink China rose over here, was the first repeat blooming remontrant rose. It was brought from China into the Western world back in the 1750s. There was no repeat blooming roses before that time in the Western world. But since then, the hybridizers have been able to bring that trait into, so with the hybrid teas, the floribundas, the miniatures, the mini floras, things that we take for granted are repeat bloomers, all have that ability because of a China rose that was brought out of China back in the 1750s.
And reminds us that we should respect our ancestors, and that that is, even on its own without the remarkable story, still a lovely rose for people to include in their gardens. Well, this has been such a joyful day for us. Thank you so much for sharing your expertise and beauty with us.
My pleasure.